Yo, what up, what up? Yeah. Peace to the gods, peace to the goddesses. Salute Black Indian Defenders. Salute the Indians. We are in a building. This you must know. We want to get into some history tonight. Oh, yeah. I see the other night we got into the Masons, right? Prince Hall Masons. And that inspired tonight's build. Because that's what was going on up in the north. So we want to figure out what was going on in the south. So it's kind of like the cats up north kind of came in to help the cats down south, you know? So we're going to get into this war and figure out exactly, you know, how it went. So, just for the record, it is a real thing, the Gullah Wars, right? And it took place from 1739 to 1858. My gee, I'm not a mathematician, but that's more than 100 years, cuz. So you trying to tell me they got a war popping off for 100 years? That's what I'm about to tell you. I'm about to explain it to you right now. I'm about to show it to you. I'm about to break it all down to you. But before we get into some good entertainment, you know, we got entertainment for you on a late night. I got to get into the books because there's some parts of it that they don't want to show you. And I told you this about the Moors and the Indians, you know? They're going to break it down to you as all civil war. It's all a fight for slavery and just things like that. But it might be a little different. It might be something more. We're going to find out today. Trust me. You know? Set the scene right quick. I want to take y'all back because I can't tell you what's about the Moors and then not show you no Moors, right? So this particular war, we already told you, 1739. We talking about Georgia. And I always tell y'all that these is two separate places. South Carolina, Virginia, kind of separate, you know, and you always gotta you gotta understand that these are two separate places, these are two separate countries, you know. And in this history, yo, I want y'all to understand that everybody is right. I know that's crazy to understand that everybody's right. There are Moors, indeed, and there are Indians. So you got to understand that. You got to figure out what's good to you. How does it make sense? It ain't about right or wrong. It's just about, this is what's popping. So people came to this country and they settled, you know. It was a year, let's see, 'cause then we got to get into the history of South Carolina. We did New York yesterday. Today we're going to do South Carolina. It's not a big deal. Let's go. All right. Mic's on, audio's working. I'm going to read from this cool page. It's from Charleston. You know? And it says, James Moore, one-time leader of the Goose Creek Men. Who is Goose Creek Men? Well, the Goose Creek Men is some European Moors. What? Priest King, you keep telling everybody it's a Moor. You want to blame all these goddamn Moors? Listen, James Moore, okay? One-time leader of the Goose Creek Men. So this is the Moor right here. And this is the Moor with his Indian associates. This is a rendition, of course, right? But this is the Moor. These are the Moor. Look at the face of these niggas, these blackamoors. They know who they are. These well-dressed blackamoors. All of these niggas up in here, tawnies. Look at this nigga. He's so black, you didn't even know that was a nigga. See that right here? Who's these niggas on horse? You didn't even know that was a nigga. You know? But okay, we're going to play the game. We're going to play the game and find out who are the Goose Creek men and who are these Moors, right? Okay. Let's see. Keep a double, triple backup plan. Everything is in groove. I'm assuming. All right. So, born around 1650. Born around 1650, married Lady Margaret Beringer, the stepdaughter of Sir John Yeamans. Their 10 children included James Moore Jr., future governor of South Carolina from 1719 to 1721. Dig these years, 1719 to 1721. They say the war popped off in 1735. Okay? Let's make sure that we're not lying on these niggas. 1739, I apologize. Here we go. Moore arrived in South Carolina from Barbados around 1675. So these is Moors coming from to South Carolina from Barbados. Now understand this Barbados situation is key. You won't hear people talking about Barbados all throughout this Gullah Geechee experience and shit. But the Moore arrived in South Carolina from Barbados around 1675, became a leading Indian trader and lieutenant of Moore, another Maurice, which is a Moor, Maurice Matthews, a leader of the colony's leading political faction, the Goose Creek Men. So this is where we get the Goose Creek Men. Let's go. As a member of the Grand Council in 1677, Moore helped direct South Carolina's effort in the West Coast War of 1680, which resulted in Goose Creek. And we all know who the West Coast is, right? The West Coast is what is these Cherokees. You see what I'm saying? They call them West Coast because they come from the West. You know what I'm saying? Which resulted in the Goose Creek faction gaining control over the Indian trade and annihilation of the West Coast Indians. So these West Coast became what they gonna call it, Yamasi Creeks. I know this is crazy, but West Coast don't exist anymore. They gonna say they annihilation, right? So during the 1680s, Moore led the protest in Parliament against a revision of the fundamental constitutions. To the shock of the Lords proprietors and many colonists, the Goose Creek men were declared the proprietors, that the proprietors could not amend the original 1669 version without advising their colonists beforehand. Like, the proprietors is the people that own the land or rights to the land. Okay. Moore also led the opposition to paying quarterage in specie, like is a certain type of currency. although the proprietors promptly switched to accepting rents paid in merchantable commodities. So they didn't want to use the specie, which is actually like a Spanish type of coin. Colonial objections stem not from anti-proprietary principle, especially since the amount concerned was small, but from the recognition that the revenue collected went to pay the cost of provincial government, which from 1683 to 1690 was controlled by Moore's opponents. So everything is peaceful until these Moors come in. You know what I'm saying? Again, I understand, like, this is still, we talking about Charleston here. We talking about Charleston, North Carolina. We're not talking about the whole state. You know what I'm saying? We talking about a small little piece. We talking about the Marshlands, which is like really Santee Island. These brothers come, brothers, right? These Moors come to Santee Island, and that's where they meet the first Indians, right? On Santee Island. So, but we want to get into their politics though, because again, you know, now all of a sudden they want to be worried about Indians now. It's like, what happened? Why are the Indians in the South? Their biggest concern of, so. Okay, here we go. Let's get back to this one. This is a really good article right here, actually, as I started with. Let's go to the topic right here. And again, we back to this Barbadoan thing. Many early Barbadians settled in the Goose Creek area and quickly became part of the richest and most powerful faction of the colony. Called Goose Creek Men, they were politically united by the Church of England. Okay, this is a factor here. Now we got a nigga named Moore, but he with the Church of England. These is cryptos. You see what I'm saying? These is cryptos. Moriscos. You see what I'm saying? He called himself a Moor, but he's not practicing Moorish behavior, right? Not if you a Christian, but maybe he is. We're about to find out. So, and their common desire to preserve the enormous profits made through the illegal Indian slave trade. So this is an Indian slave trade right here that they talk about. You see what I'm saying? This in the beginning, it's an Indian slave trade. Trafficking with the pirates who sold their ill-gotten goods in Charlestown at a fraction of the going rate. They stolen goods. So now we're talking about pirates in the Caribbean. So we got some dudes from Barbados that's cool with pirates. You get what I'm saying? You got some dudes from Barbados, from the Caribbean, that's cool with the pirates of the Caribbean. And they snatching people and they taking them back to islands. Possibly, right? Stealing everything they can get and selling it in Charlestown at a fraction of the growing rate. You know what I'm saying? I'm gonna tell you how Uber sell prices at the fraction of the growing rate just to put the taxis out of business. So let's keep going. In their heyday, the Goose Creek Men were led by Sir John Yemans, Maurice Matthews, Robert Daniel, James Moore Jr., and Arthur Middleton. Ultimately, they staged a coup and overthrew the proprietary regime. The people that owned the land, the people that was there first, that had deals and set up treaties with the Indians, these niggas come and overthrow them, these Moors. Although little is known about his origins, James Moore Sr., all y'all niggas want to be Moore, is the name Moore, right? He immigrated from Barbados in February 1675. See what I'm saying? Now we got 1675 Moors from Barbados. He managed William Whaley's Goose Creek Plantation. See, he come there, he working for somebody. He don't have his own land. That's why he want to get the land out of the hands of the people who got it. It's an early trick. They already know when you ain't got nothing, what you got to do is you got to get it out the people that got it. So he worked for a nigga, but that wasn't good enough. He worked for him for 8 years before he obtained 1683, a land grant for 2,400 acres near Goose Creek and established two plantations. Actually, he bought it. Anyway, the Buchi Hall and the Yamasi. This is the Yamasi, the Yamawasa. Yamasi. Okay. A portion of his land grant was based on him importing 37 African slaves to the colony in 1684. So now you got Africans, your first Africans being enslaved, not your first, but this is your Africans. So why they need Africans? Now we're talking about South Carolina. What's South Carolina known for? Rice and indigo. You see what I'm saying? Rice and indigo. Not no beans, corns, and squash. They're not even talking about cotton at this time. We're going to get into cotton later. We're going to get into the cotton gin. You know what I'm saying? And how South Carolina made a fortune off the cotton gin. We got you covered. But first, we in 1684. We setting up a war. You know what I'm saying? So these are your first African slaves right here. They bringing them into South Carolina, these dudes, to work and clear these fields to grow rice. Africans know how to grow rice. You're not going to get no Africans to grow no cotton, and they never seen it. But Africans can grow rice. So when you see the sister saying that she from Africa, she might be right. Some of these niggas is from Africa. See what I'm saying? And remember this, Moore also has several lots in Charlestown, where he used to sell his ill-gotten goods. You know what I mean? And these is Moore's. I mean, don't play dumb now. These is Moore's. See what I'm saying? Moore used every opportunity to increase his holdings. In addition to being part owner of two vessels, he was in a fur trade, trafficked with pirates, and engaged in the illegal Indian slave trade. See what I'm saying? This dude is a Moore. He's an opportunist. He's a straight-up opportunist and shit. He never missed. He used every opportunity to increase himself, personal, not relationships, not trying to build and grow. No, he's trying to get up. In 1690, Moore traveled 600 miles to the interior searching for additional trade opportunities and hoping to find gold and silver. Peace to the gods. Peace to the goddesses. Shout out. Everybody in the chat, see y'all, don't get out. Yeah, okay. However, he was unsuccessful in getting... Okay, so look, Moore traveled 600 miles into the interior, searching for additional trade opportunities and to find gold and silver. Now, let's go 600 miles from the coast. You're getting deep into Georgia, deep in Alabama. Now, all of this right now is Florida. This is a whole nother joint. When I tell y'all about the country, and I tell y'all how when you go south of the border, you still in South Carolina. It's a different part where a whole nother country was. That's what we're about to get into. You know what I'm saying? So he trying to, this one dude, just the same dude, these Moors. He represent a faction of Moors. And they trying to push 600 miles into the interior. And everybody was like, nah, chill out. Like other property owners in Goose Creek, Moore became actively involved in politics. It did not hurt. He married Margaret Berenger, stepdaughter of Governor Sir John Yeamans, and daughter of ill-fated Barbadian Benjamin Berenger, whom Yeamans is alleged to have murdered, just to marry her, right? So it's like, he hanging with some dudes that'll kill your mom to marry her, to get them in and get your fortune. So, of course, he probably gonna marry the daughter. He in on the secret. You know what I'm saying? And he had no choice. Like, man, Moore had a checkered political career. So I just want you to know the ilk of these niggas, the type of shit they into. Killing niggas and marry their wives, you know what I'm saying? Pass her daughter off to the next come up crazy nigga that's trying to kill everybody, you know what I'm saying? So this is how the game is being played up until 1690, you know what I'm saying? So now I'm telling you, all of this, I know we think this is Charlestown. We think Charlestown got something to do with England. Charlestown has nothing to do with England. Charles is the king of Spain, my nigga. I gotta understand this. This is South Carolina. This is Florida. These niggas is playing a game. How they dealing with the Church of England in Florida? But they on the coast, so ain't nobody really paying attention to these niggas. But when the King Charles died, see, they talk about King James. They all work for King Charles. See what I'm saying? It's a different type of world. They don't want to tell y'all the truth. So concurrently, the same year Charles II of Spain died and plunged Europe into the War of Spanish Succession. This is when you get your France and your France and your England and your Germany, whatever that shit is. You know what I mean? When Charles of Spain died in 1700. Okay? All of this. That's why they call it Charlestown, because they under the French joint. So now these niggas start picking sides now. Now England want to be their own little what's the name? They want to be popping now. So you got these Moors that's already affiliated with the Church of England that take this whole opportunity to do what? To plunder. And take a share of the slaves. All right, let's get into it, though. We're going to let her tell it, but she did a good job on the story. I ain't going to lie to you, bro. Concurrently, that same year, 1700, Charles II of Spain died and plunged Europe into a war of Spanish succession. England and Spain were on opposing sides. So now here in America, niggas that was kind of cool, they was just blurring the lines, like, you know, we ain't beefing, y'all English, they Spanish, and nobody run anything. They all just doing business. They all just trading. But now they finding excuses to go to war. And it did not take long for hostilities to spread to North America in what is known as Queen Anne's War. See what I'm saying? They don't tell you about no Queen Anne's War, because this is the prequel to the Gullah War. These niggas start growing some balls now. They start using this as an excuse to try to go south. War imminent, Governor Moore. Now the nigga went from being just a flunky, just being a nigga trying to get some money. Now he the governor. The Moore is the governor of this little, but you gotta understand this little state of South Carolina ain't a state, it's a colony, and it's a little island. It's like an island in Charleston. It ain't nothing, it's a swamp. But he got some boys with him, about to show you that shit. Watch this. So Governor Moore tried unsuccessfully to get the dissenters of the assembly to support an expedition to Spanish Florida. You know what I'm saying? He want to bring the war to Spanish Florida. They ain't what that got to do with you. They over there in Spain fighting it up. He want to go down. He want to go do a surprise attack on the Indians in the South. And we know the Indians in the South is called the Guale. Stop playing with me, bro. The Indians in Spanish Florida is called the who? The Guale. So if he going to set, he want to support an expedition to Spanish Florida, that's the Guale. They wasn't with it. This nigga dissolved the assembly and called for new elections. You know what I'm saying? By then, England was embroiled in the conflict, and the new assembly voted to capture St. Augustine, Florida. And we already know that that was the stronghold created as a fort, as a city where they could do their trading with the Spanish. They had Fort Negro, St. Augustine, but St. Augustine was the first city, you know what I'm saying? So the governor was persuaded to lead the expedition. All right. 1702, promised plunder and a share of all slaves, a force of 500 militia and 300 Indian allies, and an unknown number of slaves marched to St. Augustine, accompanied by a small fleet commanded by Daniel, by Robert Daniel. Y'all gotta understand this right here. This is what it is. It's a sneak attack. You know what I'm saying? Again, now let's find out who is in Florida right now, at this time right now. You know what I'm saying? We ain't gonna play with these things. Gonna piece it all together. Because they want you to think it's something different. They want you to think it's something totally different. I don't want to use that map, but look. You just want any map, right? Let me get a map right quick, pardon me. I know a map I like to use. I don't see it. Yeah, my map right here. It's the map I like. So all this right here is Guale. So if they cool with the Kasaba, they just went to war with the Tuscarora. Well, they ain't even much. It's 1702. They ain't even do that yet. Watch this though. They about to go to war with the Tuscarora. I mean, they did go to war with the Tuscarora. They did that after Pocahontas. That was in the 1600s. So you have to understand that it's like all of these 300 Indians that they claiming right here, these 300 Indians that's accompanying these niggas, these allies, that's not Kasaba, but that's, what's these niggas? Cherokees and fucking infiltrators that came in with their British and shit. Some of them Yamasi, that's not, I mean, like, yeah, like, look in this map, like, the maps is terrible. I know, that's what I'm telling you. I'm not telling y'all to pick a side, I'm just telling y'all history. But, like, you can't say Yamasi all the way up here. Hold on, like, look at this shit. Like, it's like, how do they get to the coast, is what I'm saying and shit. Like, a lot of this shit, it's just weird. Like, we all know the history of the Guale. These niggas got the coast. These niggas is in Darien, Georgia. Hold on. This is ridiculous. We're gonna do the easy thing. I gotta tell you, I hate the easy thing, but this, like, they can change the name. They're not thinking that you know that the Guale Indians is black and all this other shit. They tell you that it's Mississippi and culture and all that, but they're not going to expect you to connect yourself to Mississippi. Because, of course, they got us hating Mississippi and Mississippi people and all that shit. They don't tell us it's a style. Mississippi is just a river in the middle of the empire. It's like Broad Street. That's all he's saying. And all these niggas is connected by that same culture. So we missed out on all that. But, and then they just try to say it's present day Georgia, but it's not true though. Cause again, even if you, listen, let's just do this right quick. So for French settler under name of Jean Rabaud contacted the Guale, whom they called Odie, after their chief during their voyage to the Atlantic in 1562. The Guale maintained good relations with the imperial French settlement known as Charles Fort. Okay? So this is Charles Fort, where they found the Guale. Now they're calling this shit Charlestown or something else, what is now South Carolina. So now we want to say that these niggas had to go all the way to Florida to fight these niggas. Okay, cool. We will agree with that. But they're going to tell you that they attacked when the Spanish later established themselves in St. Augustine in Spanish. They also contacted Guale. They soon tried to bring them into their missions. The Guale territory became one of four primary missions of Spanish Florida, the Apalachee, See what I'm saying? This is the Temecula, the Mocama. This is crazy. So now we're going back. We say the borders of the Spanish Guale province corresponded to the people's territory along the Atlantic coast and the sea islands. This is South Carolina, cuz. You see this right here? They pulled up the map for you. South Carolina, these sea islands, these niggas that they're trying to say is Gullah, is Africans, right? They was already here. They was already here. Guale people in the sea islands. Okay, minding their goddamn business, living a Mississippi and Indian culture with beans, corns, and squash, didn't know nothing about no damn rice. So north of the Altamaha River and south of the Savannah River. This is everything we're talking about here. You know what I'm saying? So I don't want to hear that these ain't, that this South Carolina, this ain't got nothing to do with Guale in Florida. No, nigga. When the French came, they said they met the Guale in Charles Fort. So everybody in Charlestown, which was Charles Fort, is now a Guale or some other crazy shit they're trying to make these niggas. So let's get back to the story so we can just have context, understanding that who these people are going after. They're not going after no goddamn Africans. So we stay in 1702. They declare war on us. The Moors pressing the issue, making promises of free plunder and shares of all slaves. They call them slaves, but these is political prisoners. These is prisoners of war, attacked. This ain't some shit where you just buy some niggas and all shit. No, this is war. They using pretenses of Spain and Queen Anne. Like, we don't know nothing about that. The Carolinas besieged the Castillo de San Marcos until Spanish reinforcements arrived. Burning the town, the expedition forces captured 350 Indians and returned to South Carolina, leaving poor Robert Donnell in Lurch when he arrived with reinforcements sometime later. So he was dead. So they caught him. They caught him in a lurch, right? They left him out to dry. By the time they came back, he was done. But they got 350. They only had 300 Indians when they came. Now they leaving out with 350 more. They had 37 Africans. He died with 64, but he done got 350 Indians. Come on, y'all. Y'all not listening. Like, this shit is crazy. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, we want to act like it's somebody else's that's doing something. Nah, man. Let's keep going. 'Fortunately, Indian agent and cartographer Thomas Narnini mapped out Spanish Florida and had his work included in Indian crisp 1713 map. Details include a notion near the St. John's River labeled "Here Carolina Indians leave their canoes when they go to war against the Floridians." You see what I'm saying? They think this is, they think it's the Indians, the Carolina Indians, that's going to war with the Floridians. But where is Carolina? If Charleston is part of the Guale, then you got to understand that Charleston and Carolina Indians. What's a Carolina Indian? Who's a Carolina Indian? And who are ye Floridians? Florida is everywhere that ain't, you know what I mean, the British, nigga. You gotta understand that. Charleston, St. Augustine, all this is the same place to them. To us, we don't know a difference. How we meet the French and we Guale, then they say it's Spanish, and now we not Guale no more just because they changed the name. Because he came back a Frenchman. We didn't leave. The Guale didn't leave. The Frenchman left, came back in the Spanish, and now they saying It's, and that's how you get into the Negro, because the Negroes is what these Indians call themselves. Negroes, colored, gullered. See what I'm saying? So who are these South Carolina Indians that's helping these niggas go against these Florida Indians? And are they really South Carolina Indians? Because now these Carolina Indians is talking about their Cherokees. That's what I'm saying. You can't put the Catawba and the Catawbas up in this same max as the Cherokees. You know what I mean? Because again, there's a lot of new niggas that's claiming to be Carolina Indians that wasn't there when the Tuscarora was there. Like 1713, ain't no Tuscarora no more. Tuscarora is part of the Seneca. I mean, not Seneca, but the five nations, 96 nations. So if they ain't no Tuscarora, then these Carolina Indians is forfeit. It's Fugazi, they counterfeit. Tuscarora is the Carolina Indians. Catawba is the Carolina Indians. These Guale was the Carolina Indians. So who was these Carolina Indians? And I'm telling y'all, this is important when you start getting into what they call this Indian Removal Act. You got these new Indians claiming to be Carolina Indians. Like, again, where do these Westos come from? What's the Westos? Failure to eliminate the Spanish threat. See, now they're calling this a Spanish threat now. They went and attacked the Indians, but now they're giving the power away to the Spanish. But it wasn't the Spanish, though. You see what I'm saying? These is the Guale. These are the Indians keeping a foot on these niggas. Failure to eliminate the Spanish threat and expeditions caused overruns, gave the descendants an opportunity to ruin more politically. When the governor persuaded the council to delay the Senate-backed bills discriminating against the recently arrived Huguenots, the dissenters withdrew from the assembly and left it without a quorum. Here we go now. We got more Huguenots, more Black Moors, Blacker Moors coming in, and they got bills discriminating against these niggas because these are Jacobins. These are known Jacobins. These are known dissenters, and they coming after a war that they just started. Like, everybody is saying that the Spanish war was started by these Jacobins and these Huguenots. They was kicked out of all these places and wind up in Britain. Got kicked out of Britain, went to Barbados. So these Moors is Huguenots. Y'all don't know this shit, but that's what's going on in Barbados and on these islands and shit. You know what I'm saying? They got a new governor. Fortunately, Sir Nathaniel Johnson arrived at the following month with a commission as a governor and commission for Moore to be attorney general. Johnson supported an expedition against the pro-Spanish Apalachee Indians. You see? Now, when I tell you all.
Is there something else I can help with?
No, because it's black. So when I tell you all that the Apalaches is Indians, they Negroes. We speak that language, that Muskogee, what they're trying to say is a form of like an Appalachian family group. You know what I'm saying? It's like, it's part of the Mississippian, but it's like, they classify it as Apalachee. And this is that war right here. Oops. There we go. But that was the picture I showed earlier. Yeah, not that one. That was the picture we showed earlier, right here. That was the same page, actually. So this is, see right here, the raid on the Apalachee. You see this? This is what this is trying to describe right here. This is a raid. And in that raid on the Apalachee, they showing you who they believe these people were. These Moors and these Huguenots. These dark-skinned folks on horses with these dark-skinned Indians. Ain't no pale faces up in there. Like, this might be a pale face if you're trying. This might be a mulatto. I mean, I can't get at no. You know, But the point they're trying to make is they know who did what in history. They're not going to tell you because that's going to empower you. And that's going to let you know that these niggas was getting smashed around. And they had to keep trying. You had to fight these niggas for 100+ years. Had to get all types of, you know, Indian help from 300 Indians, Africans, and all types of other shit to come down here and fight niggas. So this is what they did to the Appalachian, in theory, right? So the Moor regained his reputation as a military commander when the combined force of colonists and friendly Indians massacred the tribe of Appalachian Indians. You don't hear nothing about them Appalachians. And when they say massacre, they just mean like niggas that scattered, diaspora type shit. Like you got one. Niggas ain't dead. Niggas just split. We scatter. You can have this little spot. We be back. You know what I'm saying? Because again, they attacking. These people live in a swamp. Nobody want this area, this South Carolina swampland that these niggas had. That was the worst land. So, you know, people took that on the chin. I'm showing y'all the setup. You know? So they massacred the tribe, right? With their power destroyed, the unfortunate survivors were either enslaved and taken to the West Indies or relocated to the Savannah River area. Again, these is your people that they calling these gullah now. Ain't nobody buying no goddamn slaves. They got a couple Africans, so they say. But why are you buying 337 niggas and you capturing 350 motherfuckers at a time? You sending them to the West Indies. They not bringing niggas in from the West Indies. They sending niggas to the West Indies. What damn Africans going to West Indies? It's Indians. The restless and ambitious Colonel Moore died of distemper, 1707. He was buried in St. James Church, Goose Creek's churchyard. Most historians believe that Moore's father was Rory O'Moore, one of the leaders of the Irish Rebellion in 1641, and that from him he inherited the rebellious blood of his sire. Moore's daughter married Job Howe. Job is another Moorish, Jewish name, another of the Goose Creek men. He was the great-grandfather of controversial General Robert Howe, who in 1778 engaged in a duel with the feisty General Christopher Gadsden. You know, hold on, let's keep going, let's keep that. It's about nothing. Okay, so here we go with the Tuscarora part. James Moore Jr., who inherited Buchawi Hall, had a career like his father. He was an Indian fighter who helped break the might of the Tuscarora Indians in 1711 to 1713. He later commanded provincial forces that put down the Yamasee Indians. So that's what these niggas is doing. They divide and conquer. They playing the motherfucking both sides against the middle and shit. Niggas live on a plantation called Yamasee Pet Plantation and didn't go to war with the Yamasee. Like, this is how they doing. Bring these niggas around you, use them as your bodyguards, and then straight up, as soon as you get your chance, you turn your back. They're going to war with you. See what I'm saying? And that's why the history is so crazy, why a lot of niggas can't talk about it, because they know that they close to this shit. They be more involved than they want to admit. But yeah, these niggas help break up the might of the Tuscarora. So that's what I'm saying. I don't want to hear no Indians, Carolina Indians, if you're not mentioning Tuscarora. Tuscaloosa. So although his leadership was credited with helping save the colony, once the Indian threat was eliminated, because of his opposition to their views, the proprietors removed him as the commander of the provincial forces. So these, all they do is hire Moors to attack Indians, right? These Moors are bloodthirsty. Moore was elected to serve as governor between the transition between the overthrow of the proprietary regime in 1719 and the arrival in 1721 of Francis Nicholson, the first royal governor. So, yeah, I understand too, right? They don't even have no power. Like, in 1719, it was a war. You know what I mean? It was a revolt and shit. The governor had to send in some folks. So I don't know how they acting like all this is all British all the time when they don't even have control. Up until 1700, this was Spain. So between 1702, right, and 1719, what was that? You know what I mean? Because they didn't send a British nigga, nothing royal, until 1721. So you got 20 years where ain't nobody running nothing. Ain't nobody in charge of nothing. It's just niggas acting like they got a country. Who in charge of the country? Because the first nigga that the government sent is this dude. 1721. See what I'm saying? See what I'm saying? Like, it's just crazy. But I wanted to set that up though. You know what I'm saying? Before I hit y'all with this right quick. Cause when I hit y'all with this, I don't want y'all to I want y'all to get like how a nigga can be saying that niggas is African. The Gullah Geechee is African. It's easy that you can say that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not saying they wrong. You know what I mean? It's hard to say that. And it's, but when they say they just not telling us the whole story. It's a trick. Because everybody from Africa, they got more Indian slaves than they got Africans. But watch this nigga. Listen to this nigga. Listen to all these niggas. They crazy as bat shit. Watch this. First of all, you can see the title. Gullah Geechee Roots on Barbados. You see what I'm saying? This is why we gotta connect the dots. You dig? I'm trying to tell you, because they try to flip it. Everybody right, huh? Everybody right, yeah. They trying to mix and match everything together and give you Barbados roots and shit. And ain't nobody from Barbados. That's where they sit, niggas. But now listen to this nigga. Hold on, let me make sure this right. Give me one second. Hold on. I don't know why this joint is low today. If it's output, what? Yeah, I don't know what they got going on right now, yo. Yeah, work with me for a second. My bad. I don't know what they got going on right now. Oh, shit. I bet. I be forgetting I'm good at this. I got good at this lady. I know how to present shit without having to share the whole screen. And I forgot that I've been doing that. So I was trying to share the whole screen. Right. It's a work. All right, let's go back. Cause this is what I was watching while I'm talking to y'all. Like, what am I talking about? Shout out to everybody in the room. I see y'all. My bad, y'all had to leave, but I messed it up. Here we go.
Greenwich.
Okay. So again, what we're doing here is or what they're attempting to do here is they're attempting to correlate all of this together. I just want y'all to see how it's possible.
Inquiry into the Barbados Carolina connection. So we were and are lucky and fortunate to have our Consul General, who oversees the southeastern states of the United States, and he's here. I would like to introduce him to you, and he can say a few words. His name is Consul General Neville Greenwich.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Thank you, Honorary Consul, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, friends, everyone. Let me say what a pleasure it is to be with you here in South Carolina this morning. And not only a pleasure to be with you, but to be able to speak with you briefly about our beautiful country, Barbados. And even though, like you, I'm learning more about Carolina-Barbados connection, I am fully aware of the great links that we've had between the nation Barbados and this state here, or this city, for that matter, over the last couple hundred years. The history is rich, and I must say that you guys here have been fortunate to have such a relentless servant who has for the last...
So I'm just saying, I wanted y'all to see this hijack. I mean, listen, bro, this is work. We working today. We working. We gonna do it all today. Y'all can get all this work. Don't worry. We working. Okay. So that's the hijack. Pardon me, Corey Mayo. But that's the hijack, right? That's the important, the stealing of the culture, of the land, of the identity of the true Indians that was here, and they trying to make these niggas from Barbados on some dumb shit. You know what I'm saying? So, let me get y'all out of there one more time. My bad, y'all. All right, y'all have to work with me here. I'm getting good at this. I'm trying to get good at this. Okay, here we go. All right. I want to read this to y'all. Damn, it's questions in the chat. My bad. I can't read the thing in the chat. My bad. Oh, y'all. Don't worry. Let me answer a little mayhem questions. I represent for the guys, though. Peace to the gods, Beyond Smith, Little Mayhem, Old Head in the Billing. Shout out to Zuri, peace to the goddesses. Oh yeah, Heather in the Building, shout out to the goddesses. Eno Shakur, where the Cherokee coming from? Bro, because they supposed to be from the north. They are from the north, because he's from the north side. They walked a long walk. Okay. I'm gonna read something if I can here. That's it. Shit. Cause y'all gotta understand, right? All these niggas do is pretend to have a culture. They come to America. I gotta share my whole screen because I just can't be in them. I can't read comments and I can't go back and forth. So just pardon me. Sharing the whole screen. I'm lazy as fuck. Okay. So this is where I was trying to be. In Georgia. Now this is the Black Oak Agricultural Society. Now I just told y'all about these Huguenots, right? How the Huguenots came in Georgia, The long staple cotton was first planted for market in Virginia, North Carolina, and South Carolina, the short staple. As early as 1787, quantities of cotton and seed were brought from Orangeburg District and sold to merchants at $2 per pound, who resold it principally to ladies to make patchwork bed quilts. So now we're looking at 1787 now, when niggas start talking about cotton. Who is this? This is the Black Oak Agricultural Society of South Carolina. This is official tissue. Okay. When Eli Whitley saw gin, which was the cotton gin, but they called it the saw gin, was first exhibited in Georgia, none but women were permitted to enter the room. Now you gotta understand, I'm telling y'all, cotton comes from the South. This is a Mississippian thing. Okay? The Guale had cotton. That's why you see on the picture of the mound builders, the lady dressed like a Roman. She got on a toga. You know what I mean? The Mayans be dressed up in blouses and short skirts with pleats. Cotton is different. So on these Huguenots on the beach and these sea islands, they can't grow cotton. When Whitney saw gin was first exhibited in Georgia, none but women were permitted to enter the room. An ingenious young mechanic introduced himself into the apartment as a woman's in woman's apparel, and by a minute examination of the machine, satisfied himself that he could not only imitate but improve on its construction by making it more efficient. The gin so constructed were first applied to water power by General Wade Hampton. The first attempt to raise a crop of long cotton in South Carolina was in 1788. I gotta understand that cotton comes from Mississippi. Mississippi cotton is king. So these boys ain't get down with cotton until 1788. We already into the American Revolution before the first attempt, bro. So this ain't about cotton. We all talking about wars and slavery and all this old shit. This ain't about that. We gotta understand this. This ain't about cotton picking niggas. This ain't about no slavery. This ain't about none of that backwards history that they teaching us. Okay. It's about some Moors that come here gun ho. You know what I'm saying? Come here gun-ho, ready to get loose for no reason, from Barbados. And now everybody from Barbados, they came with these Africans and they pushing niggas to be from Africa, to be from Barbados. These the niggas that kicked off the war. Nobody went to war first, but these niggas. You know what I'm saying? Now, I wanted y'all to know that, so that way when y'all hear this, y'all can know what we listening to. Damn right. Because, I mean, like, it's a lot of truth in this shit, but people don't know the whole story. So we just want to, I want y'all to know what y'all know listening to this. And you can, it might feel different. It's a couple of things I want y'all to feel differently about. You know, like when you know.
Good morning, class. And today we're going to talk about Barbados, slavery, and Gullah culture. Again, you need to make sure that you are watching these videos and that you are doing the assignment that's associated with them. So up next, we have the Caribbean connection. All right. So Barbados is an island in the Caribbean. So there's a connection between South Carolina and Barbados. So Spain controlled most of the islands in the Caribbean. But England had colonies there as well. And their most successful colony in the Caribbean was the island of Barbados. Still beautiful and gorgeous, as you can see in this picture that's on the side right here. All right, so in the 1640s, settlers thought that Barbados was the perfect climate to grow sugarcane. It became the cash crop down there in Barbados. and settlers began to use slaves to grow sugarcane and use strict slave labor codes to control their slaves. Barbados is not really a big island, but they did grow that sugarcane. It's about 21 miles long and 14 miles wide. So people were willing to leave Barbados because it was overcrowded, and there was no opportunity for poorer whites that came there. So a lot of
So I wanted y'all to see this. Everybody's starting their story off with Barbados. It's not their fault. But everybody doing that shit.
A lot of them picked up and moved to South Carolina. So that's that connection, all right? All right, it became a model. Barbados did. Became a model for the other colonies as well. Because the Carolina settlers brought their slaves with them. So when they left Barbados, they already had that structure there for slave codes. And you can look at those in your textbook. They had a structure for slave codes already in Barbados. So when those settlers left Barbados and came to Carolina, they brought those slave codes with them. Okay, so that's kind of what we see developing in the colony.
So when they came here, they had that type of slave culture with those codes. Because again, I tell you, the Indians might catch you. And they might kidnap you and what they with the European estate slavery, but the Indian ain't calling it that because they're gonna adopt you, they're gonna put you in a family, they're gonna give you a job, and they're gonna give you a wife and all that shit. They're gonna do something different. It's an adoption. But you see, they bringing a slave code, a slave system. And they wasn't bringing that really unfortunate on Indians. They was sending the Indians to West Indies. They was bringing it to Africans and to use the slave code to help them attack Indians.
In South Carolina, the slave codes that are based on slave codes from Barbados. All right, so a little bit more about the island. You can see it right there. Let's deal with slavery now. African Americans played a significant role in the development of the economy in South Carolina. That economy was based on a plantation system. Again, the economy is how you make your money. So their economy was based on the plantation system. There were a lot of crops that required a lot of workers to cultivate the land. And you can't think about it the way it is now, because now we have tractors and we have different machines, we have irrigation and whatnot that we can use to cultivate land and to grow crops. But it wasn't like that then. They used human labor, okay? And that required a whole lot of workers, and people did not want to pay.
She said it required a whole lot of workers. That's what they tell you. But the nigga only had 37 slaves. When he died, he had 64. He had 2,400 land. He had 2,400 acres, and he had 37 slaves. They said they gave him the land grant because of the amount of slaves that he had. That's what they said. So now he got these slaves. They was only 37. They gave him 2,400 pieces of land. So how much? I mean, how many slaves per acre? If you divide 2,400 by 37. You gonna probably almost have 100 acres per slave. That don't even make sense if you need all this labor. It's more than that. I'm telling you. See that she's still thinking that they growing cotton. I just showed you they're not growing cotton. They're not growing sugar, they growing rice. Rice is easier to do it. These niggas growing rice and indigo. They don't talk about rice and indigo. We about to get into it. Don't worry.
So indentured servants did not necessarily work for the South because you needed more people. And those indentured servants, again, could be set free after a certain number of years. So they also tried Native American slaves, but they were not used to cultivating the land because remember, in Native American culture, who did most of the farming? It was the women.
Now, that's a hijack. You know what I'm saying? The women did most of the farming, which is true, but then nobody knows, nobody's growing rice, dog. Men or women. Even if you ask some women, they're not growing no rice, and they're not growing indigo. You know what I'm saying? Hold on, let's go back to these brothers over here. Because this, I mean, yo, I love this person's story right here. This person's story is so crazy. The cotton culture from this time progressed rapidly in these parishes. This plant and indigo struggled against each other for ascendancy. See that? The cotton and indigo We don't know nothing about no indigo. Y'all don't hear about indigo being no main cotton, no product. But in 1793, this plant, cotton plant, was struggling with indigo against each other for ascendancy. In 3 years, the latter ceased to be grown as a market crop. In 3 years, cotton surpassed indigo, and they stopped growing it in 3 years. You see what I'm saying? So all this, we need all this labor and all this so extra shit to grow some shit y'all wasn't even growing. You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. We gotta dig into this shit root by root, because they make you think that we need all this labor, we're getting all this money from what? Indigo. Ain't no such thing as American indigo, American rice. All that shit is none of that. All that shit was a dub. You know what I mean? Everything they selling was a dub. These niggas got caught and they start popping. You know what I'm saying? But let's keep going to their family. These is the Huguenots. You see right here, it say Huguenots. Huguenots. This is the Huguenots. This is their story. Captain Peter Gallard of Rock's Plantation averaged $340 per hand. And in the same year, Captain James Sinclair at Belvedere, from a crop of 300 acres, realized the amount of 216 pounds per acre, for much of which he received 75 cents per pound, and for none less than 50 cents total, $509 per hand. When first planted as a crop, various were the modes adapted for its cultivation, but as to the distance, most proper, and the amount of tillage necessary. I mean, hold on, let's keep going, because see, we don't understand that these niggas didn't know what was going on. They don't have a clue about this. They don't have a clue what's going on with this product. Peter Gallard was born at the residence of his father at Wamba, St. James Parish, Santee. This is important. Santee, South Carolina. That's where these goosemen came in there, right? These Huguenots came in hanging out with these Moors, these goosemen in Santee. In the year 1757, being the youngest of a family of five sons and three daughters, he and David were four brothers. His father being a second time married and the birth of the first six children. The parents were among the Huguenot immigrants from France. We just told you they were starting bills in these black codes to stop these Huguenots from coming in. These Huguenots is these Moors, these cryptos, these Moriscos. See, once they got kicked out following the Edict of Nantes, who they kicking out? They ain't kicking out Christians. Why they kicking out Christians? The parents were among the Huguenot immigrants from France, following the Edict of Nantes. Peter grew up at the age of 10 before he was placed in school, and I have heard him say he believed the rapid progress he made was mainly owing to the shame and mortification he was subjected to by finding boys much his junior in age, his superiors in learning. Okay, hold on, let's keep going. Because it ain't all what you think though. These is black folks, right? These is Huguenots and Whigs. They continued until the war broke out. In consequence, the death of both David and his wife, Joanna Dubois, her W.E.B. Dubois, Joanna Dubois, French Huguenots, Peter became owner of White Plains Plantation, to which he removed and lived with Samuel Dubois for some time as planters of indigo in the swamp. I'm telling y'all, these niggas live in the swamp. If they got you, if they came and burnt down your village, you wouldn't even go chase them. You'd be like, cool, you got me. This is the pirates type of shit. You'd be like, you got me, because I don't even want to be where you at. I don't even want to burn that down. I'm going to build this up, and next time you come, I'm going to murk you. I wasn't expecting you this time. So that's what I'm trying to tell you. These niggas live in the swamp. They're excited about life in the swamp growing a plant that nobody wants. Don't nobody want no indigo, bro. Trust me. Shout out to them. It was rough. So Samuel Du Bois, taking sides zealously with the Whigs, Whigamores. We all know the Whigamore party. They call them Whigs. These is Moors, Whigamores, and the other remaining neutral. Most of the friends of Peter Geller were warmly espoused the cause of the British government. We just told you that these niggas used to be down with Spain. You know what I mean? And they left Spain and helped the Church of England, because it ain't no England. It's just the Church of England at this time. Y'all don't understand that, but I just told you about the war for Spanish succession. That's when England starts. You understand that? All these niggas is just flunkies. So now, these niggas come down here and they on some British shit. Still, Huguenots. Things remained so until the country got into the possession of the enemy. The Americans are the enemy. Y'all understand that now? Now you start seeing why some niggas can't wait to go underground, can't wait to be cryptos, go back to being cryptos, can't wait to be hidden hand type niggas, because they writing books in 1800s saying that things remain so until the country got into the possession of the enemy. This nigga writing this book in the possession of the enemy, like he ain't get over it yet. These is kids, they ain't over it. Whoever wrote this book ain't over. He's still calling America the enemy in English. You see? The British general Cornwallis called into the field most of those who had taken protection under his proclamation. And when a force was organized to hunt out Marion and his men on the Santee, Peter Gullard was appointed second in command. General, see, I understand too. Marion, that's some moron type shit. It's like moron. Having ascertained the embodying and object of the party, Sully fell upon them at Black Mingo. Shout out to all the niggas named Mingo. You know what I mean? Only person I know named Mingos is some black folks. Shout out to all the Mingos. And disperse them. This was the only occasion where an active part was taken by Peter Gullah against his countrymen. So a nigga that fought for the revolutionary and fought for the Americans was going against his countrymen, because his countrymen is all British or Church of England, Huguenots, cryptos. See what I'm saying? I need y'all, I'm just breaking it down. I need y'all to just take this to soak it all in. So when y'all hear her talking, y'all understanding what she's saying. She ain't wrong, right?
I did most of the farming. The Native American slaves did not work when it came down to cultivating land. And those Native Americans knew how to escape.
So again, she's not wrong, because they're not going to work when it comes down to cultivating no swamp. Ain't nobody's cultivating no goddamn swamp. It ain't gonna work when it come down to cultivating no rice in India, because don't nobody do that. We got bean, corn, and squash. Corn is feeding the whole damn world right now. So these niggas don't know nothing about no business. They picked the wrong products. And they got some Africans to back them up with the wrong products. So she right. But it ain't our fault. It ain't the Guale fault.
All right, so additional slaves were forced in through the Middle Passage. So what ended up happening was Great Britain and those slavers, they would go to the west coast of Africa and get slaves. People were sold into slavery and marched across Africa and brought to that west coast of Africa. And they took them to the Caribbean, to the auction block, to auction those slaves off to the highest bidder. Africans brought the following knowledge with them, though. So they were very knowledgeable. Our ancestors were not ignorant people. They had a lot of knowledge that they brought.
Now, when she's saying our ancestors, I mean, she might be right. It was some Africans brought. They might be her ancestors. That's why I put the girl on the side of the motherfucking Moors, because it might be some Africans around here acting and pretending. Some Barbadoans acting and pretending. So yeah, she could be an African, and this is what they think an African's brought, but they didn't bring all of it.
They brought the knowledge of how to cultivate land. They also knew how to tend cattle. They knew how to cultivate rice. And they had all these things when they came, because on the west coast of Africa,
they had all of them when they came. Niggas ain't fucking with no cattle. We ain't doing none of that. We ain't sleeping with no animals in no barns like these white boys do, living in houses with horses. And that's how you get diseases and syphilis and all that. We don't do none of that. And again, our cultivation of the land, we living in valleys. We living near rivers. We not living in those swamps. That's old school Mayan stuff. But niggas used to live near the swamps. They would drain the swamps and use the swamp. Nah, that's old school. We don't do that no more. See what I'm saying? And then she got cultivating rice. And we all know that's not part of the three sisters. So you don't need Indians. The Indians don't know how to do none of this shit. These niggas crazy. Getting broke. Going broke. I'm about to show you all this dumb shit they doing. They're going to be broke in 30 seconds. Watch.
All right. So Africans were used to harvest naval stores and lumber from the forest as well. So they were very skilled people. Very knowledgeable. Okay. All right, so more about slavery. So we see this picture of the triangular trade route there on the side. The plantation system caused an increase in the usage of slavery, because plantations were larger places that grew cash crops as opposed to a subsistence farm that would grow just what you need for your family and a few more people. The plantations were huge. So the more they grew cash crops and the richer people got, the more plantations they had in the South, in the United States or in the colonies. So they needed more slaves to harvest those crops for them. So in 1690s, a large scale importation of slaves began. So this is where you start seeing people pour in. A lot of them came in through the port of Charleston in South Carolina, okay?
I'm telling you, everybody's saying the same thing. Everybody not lying, it's just they're not giving us the whole story. They trying to put all the stories together. Everybody coming in through Charleston, South Carolina, Charlestown, Charles Fort. See what I'm saying? They telling you who bringing in these Africans. These Moors is bringing in these Africans. From 1690, we just showed you large scale right here in 1690. What's popping in 1690? Right? What these Moors got going on in 1690? Huh? By 1690, Moore was the acknowledged leader of the... Oh, that's what happened. The Moors is the leaders now in 1690. Let the record reflect. Everybody not lying. We just don't get the whole story. Because, I mean, shorty, she's telling like she know it. In 1690, large-scale importation of slaves began. And they all came through South Carolina soon as the Moors took over. Soon as the Moor is the acknowledged leader. He done took over the motherfuckers that was there for 100 years living peacefully. Now you got a slave trade. Now you got Moors in control. Now you got a slave trade. Now you got Africans popping up everywhere. You got Huguenots coming in. See what I'm saying? Everybody lying on these niggas? Everybody lying? We just making this shit up. No, we just don't get the whole story. Who is these niggas? Who is these slave traders? You know what I mean? Oh, they just slave traders. Like, yeah, I mean, if you just listen to this story and shit, oh, you just got some old boogeyman white boys and shit, non-existent white folks that start large-scale slavery. Yeah, from Barbados. You see how this shit, they got to have Barbados in there. Because you got some African Moors pretending to be European Moors that no other Africans, and they sending these niggas to America to help them steal land from Indians, allegedly.
So a lot of our ancestors actually came in through a few places. one being the port of Charleston, South Carolina. All right, rice and indigo demand grew more, so more slaves were needed. So people wanted that Carolina gold, and they wanted their cloth dyed blue. So those plantations expanded, and you know that they were offering subsidies to grow that stuff. So more people were getting into the plantation business.
Now, I'm telling you, that's why I have to show y'all these people telling you their story, because we get this history shit. You know, rice and indigo is in demand. No, it ain't. No, it ain't, baby. It ain't. As soon as them niggas got a whiff of some cotton, that shit was out the door. We hearing them in their own words. We hear these traders talking about how they couldn't wait to get this cotton money. How they were struggling. Over here struggling with the shit. Let's keep going. Cause see, I'm telling you, like they gonna give us some weird history all day if we let them. Hold on, where is that? Well, we gotta double check it with the people at the time and shit. They ain't got no reason to lie. You know, because it wasn't personal. None of this shit is personal. These niggas is refugees and shit, right? These niggas is refugees. Now the war is on now, right? Check this out. Mr. Gallup was afterwards under the command of General Moultrie. And in many of the engagements, south of Charleston, he served under Colonel John Lawrence, was one of the advance party to arrest the British in their retreat to Charleston, and witnessed the fall of Colonel Lawrence by one of the last balls discharged in that war. After the war was over, Captain Gillard married Elizabeth Porcher, daughter of Peter of Peru, a lady to whom he had long attached. A nigga named Peter of Peru? He don't got no last name? So some unpleasant and annoying occurrences he was fated to endure from a very few Whigs. These are Whigamores who wanted magnanimity to cast a veil over his first and youthful era. His subsequent course appeared to produce no effect upon them. Death, however, in few years quieted everything. This is the niggas that be descending against their shit. Like, if you try to fight these niggas, they gonna kill you. You try to be an American. Like, this is the one nigga that was an American. You know what I'm saying? The one nigga that was American. He fought for Americans. He fought against these Huguenots and these British invaders. And then this nigga, they couldn't do nothing but wish death on him. See what I'm saying? I'm trying to show y'all that there's people amongst us that ain't happy. That ain't happy. And they telling us a whole different story. That we all Africans and they know who they are. They know who they are. The disastrous 10 years which preceded the introduction of cotton as a market crop involved him, as it did others, in debt and distress. So where is this big money shit at? Huh? The disastrous 10 years in which proceeded the introduction of cotton so she was talking about they was getting paid off of rice and indigo demand and all this shit. This is what they teaching us. It was big money. They needed more slaves for rice and indigo. Nigga, please, you work for UPS. You know what I mean? You work for UPS, ass nigga. The disastrous 10 years which preceded the introduction of cotton did him like it did others, in debt and distress. His record book, kept the minute accuracy, states that in fact, in one of those years, the entire crop seen from one of those freshets was a few baskets of unmatured corn, which required drying in the sun before it was fit to use. You can't even sell it. A family and upwards of 100 slaves had to be sustained without money, credit, had to be obtained from the more fortunate who planted on the watery or congery. What type of shit is this? You got 100 slaves and you can't even feed yourself? You got 100 niggas and you can't feed yourself? You think he trying to do slavery? You think these niggas like slavery now? He done with slavery. You ever see some motherfuckers tired of slavery? Oh, y'all fired. No, you got to feed us. But I only got a handful of corn, nigga. You got to feed all them goddamn Africans you done brought here on this boat. He got 100 of these motherfuckers. And he living a disastrous life. A family and upwards of 100 slaves had to be sustained without money. Credit had to be obtained from the more fortunate who planted on the watery or congery. Captain Gallagher purchased the rocks in 1794 without funds, looking for nothing more than to make bread for his dependents. Do you see this shit? He got 100 dependents. This nigga, y'all say he a slave master? He a boss? He eating? He got a big old plantation with 100 slaves, and this motherfucker gotta get a second job. Imagine you go to work and you see your boss coming in from work, taking off the Dunkin' Donuts. He's taking off his Dunkin' Donuts uniform and trying to be the boss and trying to be a slave master around this mother. Oh, yeah. What? This is slavery. This is 1794. This is America, my nigga. This ain't England. This is America. This is big, big business, United States government, all this old dumb shit they talk about. You got a nigga that got 100 slaves, and he had to go get a second job, looking for nothing more than to make bread for his dependents. This is the slavery they not trying to tell you all about. Hey man, you got some land? I'm just trying to feed my peoples. I'm just trying to feed my peoples. These niggas came here, y'all seen the way they came here, the Moors, same folks, came here and killed all the Indians, killed everybody that knew how to make it pop so they could grow this damn indigo. See this shit, 1690 was when Moore came and he got control. I mean, not got came, but when he took control, he was the leader now. Same year, slavery jump off. 100 years later, when the Moors, 100 years with the Moors in control, niggas is taking second job. Niggas can't even feed the motherfucking Africans they brought. I'm trying to tell y'all, don't listen to this shit, bro. Don't listen to these niggas. They be lying. I'm gonna read this one more time, because it don't sound right. I get it. It don't sound right. It don't sound right. But Captain Gallard purchased the rocks in 1794. Without funds. I mean, he did it on sharecropping. It wasn't his land. He's an indentured servant. He working for another nigga. Looking for nothing more than to make bread for his dependents. And he has upward 100 slaves. That's what I'm trying to tell y'all. This game ain't what y'all think it is. Cotton had not been attempted as a crop, and indigo did not pay for its cultivation. But wait, they selling this shit in the history books. Indigo required more slaves, but how? If it don't even pay for itself. How? How, Sway? Indigo did not pay for its cultivation. It's garbage. Nobody wants that shit. And listen to this young lady, his beautiful sister. Everybody wanted their blue. You hear that shit? Everybody wants their blue.
All right. Rice and indigo demand grew more, so more slaves were needed. So people wanted that Carolina gold, and they wanted their cloth dyed blue.
And they wanted their cloth dyed blue. We just say whatever these niggas tell us. Oh, you going to give me an A? I got an A. And we make it better. I'm sure she didn't write that in no book. She didn't read that in no book. But she going to sell it. We gonna sell these niggas lies. People wanted that Carolina gold. What's that, rice? That disastrous ass rice? and that indigo, that they wanted their clothes dyed blue. Nobody want that bullshit, man. But this is how they tell us, and we love them so much, we believe them, and we spit it back better than they even lied to us with it. That Carolina gold, everybody love it. I mean, we just want to be slaves and happy-go-lucky slaves, and these niggas can't even afford to feed these slaves. The master's getting second jobs. Come on, y'all. We gonna let her talk.
So those plantations expanded, and you know that they were offering subsidies to grow that stuff, so more people were getting into the plantation business, and they needed more.
They was getting subsidies. Now we see why. We know a subsidy is welfare. A nigga gotta pay you to grow this shit. He gotta pay you to grow this shit. Because guess what? Guess what? Where is it at right here? Indigo did not pay for its cultivation. Somebody got to pay you for it. Come on, man. See what I'm saying? So y'all, I'm telling you, I'm told y'all, you pick your own side, bro. I'm not going to tell you what side to pick. It's not what you think. You pick a side if you want to. I'm not going to do that for you. We ain't doing it. But I'm going to tell you what you ain't, though. I'm going to tell you, you ain't no goddamn Barbados ass nigga. Yeah, you know I mean? I'm gonna tell you that shit.
More slaves, so they imported those slaves in. Okay. All right, let's take a look at this picture. This is a picture of a slave plantation from Barbados. So what do you think is being portrayed in the slave painting from Barbados? Just take a moment and look.
Now see, this ain't even Barbados though. This is South Carolina. And all these niggas is wearing cotton. So what's wrong with this picture? You see what I'm saying? See, I gotta understand, bro. This is a war out here. This is a war out here. You know what I'm saying? I like Lisa. We gonna let Lisa tell it. Even though she played. Lisa know how to tell it. Her voice is soothing to the
A lot of American history is lacking a lot of truth. If you leave it up to these
definitely shout out to Miss Lisa Caprera and her channel. Her channel blew up in a year or two or 10, but definitely this is just this again. I want y'all to hear other people's telling this story so y'all can have what y'all have now when y'all hear this story and then listen to it. You know what I mean? Like, it's like life is different when you have all the pieces. You know what I'm saying? Like, I tell you, like, I don't blame. You got to just have the pieces and decide what makes sense to you. Because again, you can't have a nigga sitting here telling me that this nigga, he an evil person, but he took on a second job to feed these niggas. Like, he's the boss. I'm not mad at this nigga. How they got here, okay, cool. I'm not happy with these Moors. But some of these niggas was bosses. I'm telling you, you gotta make your own decision and shit. They don't belong here. And we about to get into the war. We were smashing these niggas the whole time. But I just wanted to set the scene that who are the Indians and what the Indians is doing versus what's going on over here with these foreign niggas and this incursion. We know that it's some separate shit the whole time. Everybody knows it's some separate shit the whole time. These niggas up in the swamps. They admittedly in the swamps. Nobody giving these niggas no props for the swamps. Growing rice and indigo. But they tell you in history that they balling. And if you read their account, them niggas tell you they flat broke.
Caucasians to tell the story, they're going to leave out so many things. And one of the biggest things they will leave out are all of the uprisings and the moments that our ancestors actually rose up and fought back. And you may ask, why don't we ever hear about this? Because they're afraid that if you find out how hard they fought back, it'll give you the idea to rise up against them. So what they've done was create this fake history of our ancestors just being afraid and shaking and just being good slaves. It did not happen, ladies and gentlemen. Not only did we fight wars on this soil with these Caucasoids during slavery, there were fights, deadly fights, on the slave ships. And many of these Caucasoids were killed on those slave ships. Not to mention, there were a few ships where the slave.
Now, again, you know, she's doing her best now. You know what I'm saying? She's doing her best. She wants to represent the African, but she wants to represent the Indian. She don't know that they mixing the two together, though. We gotta know what we just know. We know that they mixing the two together.
Slaves were able to gain control and take the ship back to Africa. See, they're not gonna tell you all of this stuff. Now, there was something that they tried to mask and disguise as the Seminole Wars. The Seminole Wars were actually the Gullah Wars. And this is where a slave rebellion that went on in the South from 1739 to 1858, I believe. I know this says 59, but I believe it was 58. And our ancestors.
Again, let's get back to that date right quick. We're gonna let her go. My bad. We're gonna let her go. But that date, right, is important because that date encompasses 1739. That also 1858. It encompasses the whole Revolutionary War. We gotta understand that. So why they talking about there's a Revolutionary War going on and there's George Washington and all this other shit going on, there is still a known war going on with the Gullah. That niggas don't, I mean, so if there's a war going on with these niggas, you think that some of these niggas is respecting their government? If niggas is at war, who care about your government? So let's just keep the context that this is, we don't know nothing about no British and no, I mean, no Americans. If you already at war in 1739 and the war don't stop at 1775, you see what I'm saying? The war's still going. So they might have fucked around. We just might have thought a nigga changed his uniform or them niggas getting fancy this year. They took off the red coats. We don't know what they talking about.
Ancestors got together. Formed an army. These were a lot of runaway slaves. They formed an army and they were kicking the ass of those Caucasoids down there in the South, killing them left and right. Okay.
Now, who is she talking about, though? Talking about us. Because I just showed y'all that these niggas, that when they kidnap niggas, when they kidnap niggas, they kidnapping 350 Indians captured. You see what I'm saying? 350 Indians captured in 1702. Now you got 37 Africans. Come on, 37 Africans, they running away doing what? Who they joining with 37 Africans? What kind of force you got? When this nigga, he got 37 enslaved Africans. When he died, he had 64. In 1706, he got 64 Africans, but they stole 350 Indians. You don't think them niggas got busy and ran away, went back to the country? You don't think the niggas went back to the country, went back to Florida, set up shop and get busy knowing what they know now? Like, yeah, we know their whole layout, man. We know everything right now. You know what I'm saying? I don't think that's what happened. Y'all gonna think that it's 64 damn Africans that joined Indians, don't speak the language. They only been there for 10 years. How long have they been Africans? She didn't get it in 1690. See what I'm saying? But they got 300 Indians that they took. Them niggas ran away. They took them from the South. They ran back to it. He telling you that it's that they went and captured these niggas from Castillo de Marco. See that? So yeah, these niggas came back and got busy. These ain't no Africans that ran away, because it ain't enough for these motherfuckers to make a difference.
Okay. And you're about to hear about the Gullah Wars that really happened. And yes, it went on for over 100 years. And it just go to show you this fakery of our ancestors got put in their place by this Caucasoid all the time. It didn't happen that way. Many times there were uprisings. Many times they got killed in high numbers during this 100 years, but they won't tell you this. So let's go ahead and watch this video on the Gullah Wars.
Black history is taught like this. You started off as a slave, then white folks felt bad and decided to free you. Then civil rights legislation made you equal. And finally, you achieved victory with Obama's election. The end. Of course, that is ridiculous. That is the white supremacist version of Black history. The end result of this miseducation is that Black children are separated from their own people's legacy and historical achievements. Everybody in the world has the right to draw inspiration from their own people's legacy. And this right is robbed from Black children because their history is actively hidden, distorted, and replaced with make-believe. For this video, we will carefully cover the facts on how Black people became liberated from American chattel slavery. The miseducational system has taught us three gigantic myths about the freeing of the slaves. Right. The first myth is that there was only some slave rebellions here and there, but not any kind of large-scale military resistance to slavery initiated and carried out by Black men. The second myth is that any slaves who wanted freedom basically fled north.
Okay, so again, now knowing what y'all know now, y'all know what a slave rebellion is. Y'all know who these slaves is. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what we got to understand, who these slaves is. We don't want to just be saying these slaves, because the slaves are 64.
The third myth is that the Civil War was the primary event that ended chattel slavery. The reality is that there was a series of battles, revolts, and rebellions that lasted from 1739 to 1858. This was the Gullah Wars. That is more than 100 years of warfare totally hidden from the American history books. A lot of this history was disguised as the Seminole Wars. First of all, the Seminoles were not a real Native American tribe. They were Native Americans allied with and often led by Black Africans. Seminole literally means runaway. Maroon means fugitive. Gullah refers to the Black Africans. The Emancipation Proclamation was a staged event, and it was designed to stop and historically hide the self-liberation process of Africans in America. Africans were brought into the Anglo-American New World Order, and many of these Africans maintained the goal to kill, crush, and destroy white supremacy. 1739, the Gullah War begins. Carolina was about to pass the Security Act, which would require whites to be armed more often to prevent a slave uprising. So the slaves decided that this was the time to strike. About 20 of them went to the local store, stocked up on guns and ammo, killed the shopkeeper, and began the Stonewall Rebellion. the rebels marched, and as they marched, their following grew larger and larger. They chanted out liberty as they marched, chasing the slave owners, killing them, and burning their houses down.
So you got to understand what's happening here. This is still Charleston. Look, right? You got people that's with that shit. That's into that. You know what I'm saying? That's like slaves, that's really slaves, that's trying to rebel, right? But what y'all got to understand too is that there are other Indians, like I told y'all. So, all right. When I tell y'all this nigga came down here with 500 militia, but 300 Indians. I mean, you almost got as many Indians as you got militia, quote unquote. So what these Indians get? These Indians get slaves too. They get people. They get land. Plunder. You see what I'm saying? So you got Indians that's not, like y'all gotta understand, like, it's an Indian Removal Act to get these Indians, these Indian allies, these Indians that's helping these niggas capture 300 Indians up out of there. You ain't gotta be upset about a Indian removal when the Indians they not from there. They was trying to give it up because they captured it. It was trying to sell that shit. We think that these niggas was trying to hold on to it. No, this is spoils for these niggas. All of this shit is a war. These motherfuckers is acting like that the Indians that's down there, you understand, they try to break them up. You got red sticks and white sticks and what happened to the Guale? What happened to the Gullah and shit? Now the Gullah is the slaves. They went from being the Indians that the French met in Charles Fort to now they just Africans. You see what I'm saying? So all of this shit is a war. All of this shit is a war. There was never no peace during none of this time. Like, that's what y'all gotta understand. There was never no peace. These niggas live in forts and in towns. What they calling a civil war was just a culmination. And the reason why they stopped it in 1850 is because I told you, 1858, is because it was those Indians that got removed, they tried to take their slaves. They tried to take Indians that they captured. You think Cherokees got connections to get Africans? Everybody telling you that these Cherokees and Choctaws got slaves and freedmen. Where they get them from? You got 350 Indians right here in one shot. This one battle, 1702, they've been battling. They don't include this in the Gullah Wars because this ain't part of it. This is a jump off. This some shit they hide. They're going to hide their hand when they throw the first rock. They're going to make it seem like the Gullah did something. But when you attack the Gullah, it don't start a Gullah war. If you go down to their land and you march with 300 fucking Indians and 500 militiamen and an unknown number of slaves, y'all niggas march into their territory to St. Augustine, that ain't war on a Guale. Now they, as I'm saying, they don't even want to use these niggas' names and talk about these niggas no more and shit. History will make it seem like it never happened. Here, the Carolina Indians leave their canoes when they go to war against the Floridians. That's all I'm saying. And again, this is 1713. So when I showed y'all, when I told y'all that 1713 is after the Tuscarora War, I wasn't lying to y'all. 1713. You know what I'm saying? Tuscarora War 1711 to 1713. You see what I'm saying? So these niggas out here playing games, trying to get rid of all the Indian empires, all the mound builders. It's mounds out there in South Carolina on Goose Creek. It's Indian mounds out there. It's some mound building Indians that used to live out there on Goose Creek. Some Santee Indians might have just moved in some shit, but it's a mound building culture in South Carolina, because when they came to Charles Fort, they met Guale. So that's not, you know what I mean? We don't want to get too far off the story with this shit. With these Africans and these Africans, but I want y'all to hear it so y'all can know it when y'all see it and y'all on your own trip. We know what this is. This is a hijack. It's like, fuck it. They don't know what else to say. Everybody want to do their best. We all trying to tell our best story of the shit, right? But the shit don't make sense. We want to say they're Africans because they told us we Africans. You know? Let me get this nigga some play. He kind of write this shit. But that's why we got to keep it separate.
Black history is taught like this. You started off as a slave, then white folks felt bad and decided to free you. Then civil rights legislation and finally you achieved victory with Obama's election. The end.
I forgot.
Of course, that is ridiculous. That is the white supremacist version of black.
So again, don't forget that the Negro,
which prevented a future rebellion by limiting the rights of the slaves. From that point in time until 1812, the Gullah were fighting continuous battles against the state militia in Florida. Spain was fighting against the American colonists for land in Florida. The Spanish started arming the Gullah and providing them with military training. The Gullah used this military equipment and training to defend their own free, independent black towns. The first black town in North America was called Garcia Real de Santa Teresa de Mose. It was built by the black man and officially recognized later by the Spanish Lieutenant General Montiano in 1738. This black town was a place that slaves could escape to have their own land and receive military training. 1814, Andrew Jackson defeated the Native American Creek Confederation. He imposed on them the Treaty of Fort Jackson, which basically stole their land.
But again, that's not their land. We already know that. That ain't the Creek land, right? Then we got a map. That ain't the Creek land. So all that shit that they saying is Creek land, that ain't their land. They shouldn't be down here. It shouldn't be no Creeks. It shouldn't be no Cherokees. It shouldn't be no none of that shit should be down here, bro. It should be Guale, Apalachee, Temecula. Down here in south, below the swamps. Below Charlestown. We give y'all North Carolina, us North Carolina to Cassava. To the Tuscarora up here, all the way up in here. But back here, why is Choctaw and Chickasaw people over here now? So they gotta get removed. That's what I'm trying to remind y'all. Don't get teary-eyed and goose because they over here. They shouldn't be over here. That's part of this hijack. That's part of these niggas sneaking over here, starting this Gullah Wars. Every time these niggas get a piece of land, it's a fight, it's a war. It's Appalachian, it's Guale, it's Temecula. I don't want to see no creeks down here. That don't make sense. You see what I'm saying? Only reason why it makes sense is because it's a hijack. So when Andrew Jackson get them out of there, he's doing what's right. I know it seems crazy, but they don't belong there. He trying to stop the war. He trying to stop, like, again, this is what with these niggas, they trying to, like, that's how the government use motherfuckers, though. Like, we know what this U.S. government do. We know their track record, how they use niggas to start an insurgent, and then they turn on these niggas. That's what they did to them Creek and them niggas. They turned on the motherfuckers because they don't belong there.
So Chief Sacafoga led thousands of his warriors to Florida and joined forces with the mighty Gullah Nation. The so-called Indian Wars were actually the Gullah Wars. General Thomas Jessup said, "Throughout my operations, I found the Negroes the most active and determined warriors, and during the conferences with the Indian chief, I ascertained that they exercised an almost controlling influence over them." This,
now again,
you may be assured, is a Negro and not an Indian war.
Man, that's a hijack. The Negro is the Spanish, nigga. It's the Spanish Indian, is the Guale. That's the Negro. Now they speaking Spanish. He ain't saying Africans. You don't think he know a goddamn African? He know what he's saying. He know he's saying that these quote-unquote Indians that they fighting is the Indians that used to be their friends. Now they up here hang out with these Negroes in the South. You only get Negroes when you're dealing with the Spanish shit, when you're dealing with Florida and the Floridians. You see, nobody know what to call these niggas. They Negroes. That's why you got a Fort Negro. You see what I'm saying? He know what they doing. Like, they try to make it seem like this got something to do with slaves. Ain't nobody getting no Africans but these goddamn Huguenots and these damn rice builders.
1816, the Battle of Negro Fort. Negro Fort was a structure built by the British and occupied and led by Black Gullahs. Andrew Jackson ordered Colonel Clinch to destroy Negro Fort. After they destroyed Negro Fort, Andrew Jackson ordered the torture of the leaders.
So this is a fort that they built, that they say that the British built. You see what I'm saying? In Florida, right? They call it a Negro Fort. Come on.
The enslavement of the Black captives. This was a historical turning point in Gullah military strategy. The Gullah leaders who escaped decided that they would never again use the British strategy of fighting from a fixed fortified position. They decided instead that they would return to using the traditional Gullah method of guerrilla warfare, which involved striking and vanishing, luring the enemy into strange areas, the forest, the pasture, the swamp. They had the advantage with decentralized warfare because they knew the land better. As more and more slaves fled south for freedom, thousands of U.S. soldiers died at the hands of the superior Gullah warriors. 1818, the Battle of Suwanee. A stretch of towns along the Suwanee River was occupied by a series of self-sufficient Native American and Gullah colonies. Once again, General Andrew Jackson came to terrorize and invade them. The Gullah and the Native American warriors, allied in the swamps, inflicted heavy damage on the invading army. Andrew Jackson was defeated by the Gullahs, however, he fraudulently claimed the battle as a victory. After the Gullah warriors and their allies disappeared into the swamps, Andrew Jackson exacted revenge against them by slaughtering a nearby settlement of their women and children. The killing of women and children was the only victory Andrew Jackson achieved in the Battle of Suwanee. This Black history was actively hidden. Whenever the word Black or Negro or African were mentioned in war reports, the words were simply omitted or replaced with an asterisk. The Gullah Wars were also hidden from the newspapers so they wouldn't scare away potential European settlers. Real American history shows that the Black man was destroying the institution of slavery.
It's not that it's the slavery. It's these prisoners of war. It's these Moors. kidnapping people, breaking up the Tuscarora Indian. That's what it is. Like, we don't talk about these wars, these attacks on our motherfucking institutions, these attacks on our empires. That's what we're doing. We get, it's get back. It's get back.
1922, the resistance had grown completely out of control.
You see what he said? The resistance. It's get back. Y'all keep saying Florida and British, and we don't care about all that. It's get back.
The United States government. In Charleston, South Carolina, almost all the slaves in the area had joined a movement to carry out a massive slave revolt. What white people had not considered is that every time you capture a free Gullah warrior and sell him into slavery, the Gullah warrior will only spread his own knowledge amongst the new slaves he's living with. This rebellion was to be led by Denmark Vesey and his lieutenant Peter Poyas. 9,000 slaves were planning to revolt that day. However, the revolt never actually took place because cowardly black people involved with the movement informed the white colonists of these plans. Everyone involved ended up being executed or sold away to another plantation. 1835. The victory over the King Fort Relief, otherwise known as the Dade Massacre. The reason it was recorded as a massacre instead of a battle was to hide the fact that it was a legitimate military victory for the Black Gullah. Also in 1835, the U.S. Army suffered another defeat at the Withlacoochee River, forcing General Gaines to leave Florida. 1837, Colonel Taylor...
Like, y'all gotta understand, like, shout out to this nigga, like, it was really that serious, though. Like, it was really that serious. Like, they just
kept Okeechobee as a victory for the United States. In reality, the Gullah warriors and the Native Americans had already started fleeing the area and spreading the Gullah resistance to other parts of America. The real war that ended slavery was not the Civil War, it was the Gullah Wars. It was Native Americans and Black Muslim Gullahs against the white Christian colonists. The so-called Civil War was carried out for elitist banking and business interests, and it also served as a formality, a ceremonial ending to chattel slavery. In reality, slavery ended in America because it couldn't be maintained against the constant guerrilla attacks, and the only way to stop those attacks was to make slavery illegal. The free black man would not tolerate slavery.
Now that's, again, this your Huguenot right here. Don't get it fucked up. This your Huguenot. He got the wrong picture up there. That's your Huguenot. But he's right about this. The slavery cannot be maintained. I just showed you the record of a slave owner with 100 slaves that can't feed his slaves. He doing everything right. He got everything by the book. The rights in the indigo. He got all the acres, but he can't make money. The crop don't grow itself. So slavery was not working, y'all. Understand that. He had to purchase a whole nother property in 1794 without funds, looking for nothing more than to make bread for his dependents, for his 100 slaves. So that American dream of the slavery shit was not working. It had nothing to do with slaves. What it had to do with was these bum niggas kidnapping people, stealing land. And when you come over here, like I say, they had 300. Like, understand this. They had 300 allies, Indians, and they came and they kidnapped 350. Nobody's going for that, bro. Nobody's letting that die. You know what I'm saying? Nobody's going for you stealing 350 Indians out the blue. Just wake up one day and they come through burning the town. You know what I'm saying? Like, and that's what I'm saying. You gotta understand what these Indians do. Like, so this town right here that they burnt probably became a creek town. Castillo de San Marcos is probably a creek town. You gotta understand that it's parts in Georgia right now, and that's Cherokee County. Why is parts of Georgia Cherokee County? Because they took it. Why? They took it, y'all. You see what I'm saying? So when you gotta get these niggas out of here. You can't have a Cherokee County in Georgia and they from North Carolina. They the same Carolina Indians. You know what I'm saying? They're the same Carolina Indians that leave their canoes and go to war with the Floridians, with the Guale. So if they from Carolina, why they got Georgia, Cherokee County in Georgia? You know what I'm saying? So we gotta know, and when you see this castle right here, you're not looking at no Americans, dog. Don't get it fucked up. This Yee castle with this cross, you ain't looking at no Americans at all. These guys. These are the Huguenots. You see this right here? It's Huguenots. That's what I'm telling you. I ain't mad at niggas because they can't even afford to pay their dependents. Niggas got 100 slaves and can't feed them. You know what I'm saying? But that's what happened. That's what's really going on. You see what I mean? Don't sit here and tell me that these niggas making all this buku money. These are the Huguenots. These ain't no Indians. Indians ain't doing that. Indians ain't playing them parts. You know what I'm saying? We was going to war to get our folks back, like we should. You gotta understand that shit. Yeah, I understand it. Like, these niggas
claimed the battle as a victory. Hold on. Wait. After the Gullah War.
You take
the 28th. The year was 1835. The soldiers, 100 enlisted men, and 8 officers, 5 of them West Point, under the command of Brevet Major Francis Langhorne Dade, were ambushed and killed by Seminole Indians. At the end of a day-long battle, only 2 soldiers survived to make their way 50 miles back to Fort Brooke and the collection of settlers' huts and shacks around the fort. It was beginning to be referred to as Tampa. Just across the street.
Telling you, bro, you think it's easy around here. These niggas got y'all thinking it's sweet. They just running up on y'all, taking land and just doing stupid stuff. No. God is the best of planners. We don't just sit back and watch it because they like to attack. The white, you know what I mean? They like to attack. The white move like to go first. The white piece like to go first, huh? You know what I'm saying? The white piece like to go first. They like to attack. But that don't mean that's the end of it.
From where I stand. Following 300 bloody years of Indian wars since the European invasion of America, this battle began the Second Seminole War. At 6 years and 7 months, the longest Indian war in American history, a war that almost destroyed the Seminole tribe, sent blacks into slavery, opened Florida for white settlement, and made it possible to transform a vast battleground into the nation's playground.
Why you said he was writing a book?
Said I was writing an essay, and it requires some shut mouth.
Don't waste your time on those junkyard losers. This country was built on genocide and slavery. We killed all the black guys that were here, and then we shipped in new black guys of our own.
What? What?
Killed all the black guys that were here, and then we shipped in new black guys of our own.
What?
Killed all the black guys that were here, and then we shipped in new black guys of our own.
What? What?
Killed all the black guys that were here, and then we shipped in new black guys of our own. And then we brought in Jesus like a bar of soap.
Let's go.
You know it. I am the religious correspondent.
You see? Plain sight. You see what I'm saying? They brought a new black guy from Africa now to grow this rice and corn. They got 100 of these niggas that they can't feed now. Ain't nobody trying to run away. Ain't this the time to run away when a nigga can't feed you? What you need? What you need, slave? What you need a army for? And this nigga gotta get a second job. When he leave the house, they go work the night shift. We out. You know what I'm saying? How many meals you gotta miss to be out? How many meals you gotta miss to be out fucking with these Moors that died with 64 slaves from Africans, and they all Africans, right? Gotta be, right? He had 37 from Africa. I believe him. Because that's their trick. Their trick is to replace us with their own black people. With some more Huguenots. Ain't nobody want them Huguenots here but them, but the Moors did. Couldn't wait to get some more African lookings. For what? In 1690... he opened up the slave trade. All the slaves started coming in South Carolina as soon as the Moor was the recognized leader. The slave trade opened up, right? And they brought in their own black people. And then they hit us with Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, it's these same Moors pushing this Church of England shit. We think they're supposed to be Africans. No, these niggas Christians. They anything but an Indian, anything but the truth.
Fuck off with your Jesus beliefs. The Bible's God's book. Why didn't he give it to everyone?
You say, fuck off with them Jesus beliefs. See what I'm saying? It's like, bro, we gotta wake up out of this joint. You know what I'm saying?
To me, and they don't look like the Indians. Maybe we say politically correct or not politically correct. They don't look like Indians to me, and they don't look like Indians to Indians.
Let's go back in time when the American Indians looked like I look.
So yeah,
black history is taught like,
see what I'm saying here? And again, we need to understand the importance of that, though. The importance of how all of that shit started. Everything was all good. Niggas was minding their business till they came with that old dumb shit. So we about to get flagged for this one, don't worry.
Vote or I'll blow her head off. As a father, as a parent, you'll probably put those chains on and sit down in that boat. Now generations go by and people are born into slavery. Once you are born into slavery, hell, you think you are a slave. In Frederick Douglass's biography.
Now remember that I'm telling you, I showed y'all that, hey, there's some Africans. But the majority of people ain't going through this. And if these niggas ain't mistreating these slaves, that they gotta do the unthinkable for these slaves and work extra hard for these slaves. And I've read y'all Frederick Douglass' book, how his slave master used to hold his hand and call him his little Indian boy. So this nigga is Indian. We already know that he a Bailey, they Accomack Indians, they traitors, and they love these crackers. They kiss them in the mouth. We know that. We know that.
Back into slavery. Because that's all they knew. When you can control a man's mind, when you can brainwash him, you don't have to worry about his actions. The Gullah Wars is the part of history that they tried to keep from us. They've tried to disguise this as the Indian Wars, and they've also used many other names as this. The Civil War did not free us. President Lincoln did not suddenly gain a conscience and thought to himself, you know what? This is wrong. We shouldn't treat these people like this.
We gotta stop it, man. We gotta stop it, Johnny.
We freed us. We freed ourselves. And this was through the Gullah Wars. The Gullah Wars lasted from 1739 to 1858. These were military-minded runaway slaves. The myth that all slaves fled to the North. No. More than half of them went south. They went to Florida.
Right. Why would you go to the North? You don't know nothing about the North. They didn't kidnap you from the North. They kidnapped you from the South. They're not going up North creating wars with the Indians in the North. Okay, maybe the Tuscarora, but that's not what we're talking about. Because the Mohawks, we already established that the Mohawks ain't beefing with these niggas. They traitors. They trying to kill every damn beaver, every damn deer in America to sell and trade with these motherfuckers. They ain't fighting. They ain't beefing with no damn colonists. They trying to keep them alive so they can sell them all the furs.
They want to tell you that all the slaves went to the North because they're trying to throw you off from the rebellion. The rebellion that took place for over 100 years. The slaves would run away and head to Florida. This is where they built their own military.
Now again, Florida is everything south of the border. Where is south of the border at? South Carolina. South Carolina is south of the border. When you're driving down 95, you see that south of the border, nigga. You know you're in Florida. You know you're a Floridian.
Whenever a runaway was captured, he would come back to the plantation and let everyone know what's going on. And if that runaway didn't get captured, he would tell the people in Florida where the plantation was. Give them information about the plantation, where they can hit them, where this is hidden, where that's hidden. Letting their comrades know where to go and what to do. See, the Gullah Wars were vicious, but they had cohesiveness. They had the mindset of either we'll take our freedom or we'll die trying. Hundreds of angry slaves going to town, plantation to plantation, overwhelming everything in their paths. And they was killing everything. People were getting their heads chopped off. People were getting set on fire. And they didn't care. This included women and children. Because you have to understand this. Yes, that may be graphic. But now, it was their turn to do the killing.
Now again, you know, again, these is not African slaves that's doing this revenge, that's claiming this land. You know what I'm saying? These is Indians. These is bean corns and squash groves. This is the Temecua. These is the Gullah. These is the people reclaiming their land that these people that came down here and took and stole and kidnapped 300 of us. You dig? So yeah, I wanted y'all to get that, man. I hope y'all got that. Boy, 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 we've been going tonight, man. We've been going in tonight. Shout out to y'all. Man, I don't want to get too graphic. I'm already banned today. Once, right? Oh, shit. But yeah, man. that part, bro. That shit banned 60 states, right? But yeah, man, I got to work though. But you get to see it. I'm just saying, you get to see it. You get to see it. You get to see why these niggas is talking about.
I'm going to make a bold statement and say that doing a TEDx talk is going to be
being African, and why the hijack is so serious, because they got some black folks in blackface sitting here ready to steal your land.
Battle, to improve not only the connections between the two parties, but to ensure that you here in the Carolinas learn about Barbados and that
your respectfully.
So great that you
hallelujah. He's so cool. But yeah, though, respectfully, though, you get it. And that was the point about the cotton gin. You know what I'm saying? I got the cotton gin. Y'all see that them niggas wasn't making no money. Y'all see that slavery shit they be talking about ain't really slavery. It's like you don't want to be, you don't want to hold no slaves around this motherfucker. Trust me, that's the last thing you want to do around here when this shit is, when these niggas is in debt and distressed. You know what I'm saying? You don't want to own no slaves. And it's been like that for 10 years. And there's a war going on for some slaves that some niggas before you done already took. You don't know nothing about it. You probably sitting on stolen land. So I'm just saying, I want y'all to understand, like, none of this happened. Like, none of that stuff that we was just being kidnapped and being abused, none of that happened. Ain't nobody being no slaves. And these, like I say, and you think about this, though. Think about this. Like I say, how many, you got 100 African slaves, bro. They his dependents. And this nigga had to get another job. He had to go get some more property just so he could make bread. This is a quote. He had to do this so he can make bread. Don't believe the hype, y'all. They make you think these niggas is balling, these big slave masters. He had 100 slaves. He had 100 dependents. That's not how y'all think of slavery, though. That's not how they teach you about slavery. Like, slavery is 100 dependents. Come on now. You got 100 people and you can't feed yourself. That's like, they not, I mean, come on now. That don't even sound right. They couldn't put that in a history book. But that's the truth. You see what I'm saying? That's the truth. So they kind of, I just want us to see it. That they didn't even get cotton into the motherfucking 1790s and start really popping on the shit to the 1800s. So it ain't no big money with this. Ain't no big money with slavery. Slavery almost over by the time they're trying to really get this cracking. And they doing it with Africans, bro. Like, man. Peace to the guys, man. I got any questions or something? That was, I don't know. Peace to the universe of God, life. Peace to little man. So it was a good build. I appreciate the guys. That was a good build. I had fun. I hope we empowered. I hope we got some strength out of that. Because it's the resistance. The resistance is not over. They just lying to us, y'all. I mean, don't it make you feel good, though? That they just lying. Seriously, it could be worse. You know what I mean? Like, it could be true. But no, it ain't true, y'all. These niggas are starving, trying to front like they got 100 workers. No, you got 100 dependents, man. And they did the right thing. Shout out to them. He got a second job. A nigga went to work for UPS. He had the night shift. Trying to be a slave owner. He had to get another job. So yeah, peace, y'all. Who wanna be messy in the morning? We still at war. Talk that shit. We still at war. Salute the resistance. Salute the resistance. We still at war. We gotta be. I'm trying to tell you, bro. Peace to the God. Peace to the goddesses. Appreciate the love. It was a blast. Super fun. I'm glad I could share this. And we got to get deep, yo. We got to get deep. I'm telling you, y'all can handle this deep shit. You know what I mean? Shout out that Carolinas in the building, bro. Shout out the Carolina Indians. You know what I mean? That's what they call y'all. The Carolina Indians. You know what I mean? So, yeah, man, this is exciting, bro. Shout out to everybody. Hit the like button, man. Maybe get this in the algorithm. Let some more people feel empowered. Let them know the resistance is still here. Yeah, we still at war. You dig? Smashing on niggas. Peace to the gods. Peace to the goddesses. Salute Black Indian Defenders. Salute the resistance. I'll see y'all tomorrow. 100.